Now, also tomorrow night, the Knights take on the Cowboys. You see that at 9:30. That's our second game. First of all, to you, Paul Harrigan.
Yes.
Mate, we just keep reading about Newcastle in the newspaper. The Kirk Reynoldson thing. What's the latest on that? Has it been resolved yet?
No. I think, unfortunately, and probably through the media, is that it seems now that it's gone into legal terms in respects to with the contract. So it's kind of out of the Knights' hands at the moment. They're dealing with it on the legal side, which is unfortunate. It's been difficult for everyone in the town, especially for Kirk. He's a wonderful fella and the club, but that's the way that seems to be panning out,
unfortunately. Can the club recover from this? There's been a massive backlash against the club publicly.
Now, it's without a doubt, I've never seen scrutiny like this before with any club. It's been very tough for us. But there's only one way for us to go now. Brian Smith will be judged on next year.
Okay.
And the club will move forward and we'll do that and we'll do the best we can. That's the only thing we can do.
Chiefo, there's speculation today that Danny Medeiros is possibly looking to go to the UK Super League, maybe as soon as next year, and asking for a release. What can you tell us about that?
Well, look, I speak to Danny and Steve Simpson quite regularly, and that's from my understanding, and I can't speak on behalf of any of the boys, but that's certainly not the case. And those two blokes in particular are the heart and soul. In fact, they're exactly what Newcastle stands for, and there's no way in the world we'll be letting one of those blokes to go anywhere. We're building the club around them, not letting them go.
So Bedsy went up and knocked on the door at your mansion there and said, Chiefo.
Which one?
The one he's going to build after that skull comes out. Chief, mate, I've had a big offer to go to England for Warrington or whatever. I want to go. You just say no.
Mate, again, look, I can't speak on behalf of the board and I can't speak on behalf of Danny, but all I can say is that our club won't be letting... I have no intention. We want to build the club around him. You know, we'll make other changes. We're not letting him go anywhere or Steve Simpson. They're the blokes that we want to be there.
All right, so Newcastle fans, stick solid and get there tomorrow night to see them take on the Cowboys. All right, the man who knows everything there is to know in rugby league, Danny Whitelaw.
Thanks, Fat. Well, look, let's start with the Newcastle Knights first up. There's been plenty of speculation about the future of Knights captain Danny Medeiros. There's talk he could go to England next season. I spoke to his manager, George Mimas, earlier today. George assures me there's no way that he'll be there in 2008, but he could be in England in 2009, more than likely, in fact.
I notice you're tipping the Panthers there, which will help your club get the wooden spoon.
I don't know what happened there,
It's coming over. Bend over, Chief. Here it comes.
Hey, can I ask you a question? Why is the wooden spoon...
I'll give you the one.
Why is that for coming last? What's a wooden spoon mean?
This is the one from 2005.
It's on.
I'll take your 1v1.
Okay, let's hear now from Graham Murray and also Brian Smith is what they had to say at the media conference.
We're just proving to ourselves that if we play a nice, tough and you know, complete our sets and do the little things right for each other, that you know, we've got some points in us and we can win games.
The build-up was great. Boys were committed. The execution was the only thing that you can be critical of tonight. And the execution by the opposition was pretty hot at appropriate times and ours on some very critical plays tonight, try-scoring plays, that went astray for us.
Yeah, some stars missing once again there for the Newcastle Knights, but they certainly had a real dig, didn't they, against the North Queensland Cowboys in their final home appearance of the season. Next week, they travel to Telstra to take on the West Tigers in round 25.
The deadly duo with a hand in all but one of the Cowboys' 6 try run.
Thurston's with it. He's got time. The door's open again.
But the boys from the North didn't have it all their own way. Cooper Vuna using a classic Maori sidestep for the opening try. With Reynoldson again reduced to spectator status, the Knights were down 16-6 at half-time, but two quick tries gave them the lead and a sniff. Until the game-breaker from Ashley Graham, Newcastle with space out wide and looking almost certain to score, but for Graham's hand of God.
I think if the ball goes to any one of two or three of our players, we're likely to score, and didn't it went to one of theirs, and that was a great catch. That was a great catch.
Brian Smith looking on in frustration. Graham's try against the run of play summing up the Knights' season. The Cowboys easy winners by 16 points.
The brilliance of Matt Bowen has helped the Cowboys seal a top four finish. Even besieged Knights coach Brian Smith could appreciate that.
He's some player, that Matty Bowen.
While there was no faulting the Knights' commitment,
Patterson!
In the end, it was the class of the Cowboys which won the day, and their freakish fullback in particular.
The fullback for the Cowboys!
Chris Hodgkinson, National 9 News.
OK, well, let's have a look before we get into the four matches that have been decided over the weekend. Obviously, one of the burning issues this week, and it's received plenty of press, too much, in my opinion, way over the top. The situation at Newcastle now, after going down on Friday night, they are the favourites for the Wooden Spoon. But the real issue has been Kirk Reynoldson and his situation up there. Do you have an opinion on what's going on?
I do. I think it's been poorly handled on both sides. I mean, I think it was an issue that needed to be resolved at the start of the year. I can't understand why Kirk wasn't told he wasn't required by the club next year at the start of the season. The other thing I can't get my head around is, I think 7 or 10 days ago, Kirk Reynoldson came out and publicly stated he didn't want to put any pressure on his teammates. He didn't want to drag this through the press. And then every day since then, I've seen Kirk in the paper, some story about his mortgage or sick kid. I know that's the human side of it. But it's got to
real
a point,
issues. They're real big issues for him.
Mate, it's got to a point today where I think Daniel Abraham's come out and said that he's prepared to sit down so Kirk can get a spot on the side. Like, that's...
I feel for Kirk, no doubt about that, but he is facing the reality of professional sport. Yeah.
It's a business.
Now, we discussed the contractual element of it. Now, his manager or the club have put in the contract 15 games to get activate the next year's contract. I know when I played, Pete, I had a sum that I, you know, I had no clauses to have to achieve certain games.
The real culprit is that whoever agreed to that clause being in there. Like, what happened to the days where you negotiated with a club? The club put forward an offer what they were happy to pay the player what he would play for. You came to that gross figure, and the only incentives in there were for representative football.
Correct.
And we got on with it.
It's not like he's been a player that's been in first grade every week. I think he's played something like 50, 60 games over the 3 years. And the other thing that I've got a bit of mail on is that I think the Raiders are pretty keen to pick him up.
They're just sitting idle while he goes through his court.
I disagree with you on that. With Kirk Reynoldson, I reckon he's a good, consistent first grader. I'm finding it hard to swallow that he wouldn't have been picked bar that financial decision, understanding is what the club is saying.
And that's the point. It has been poorly handled on both sides, I think, by Kirk and his management and the Newcastle club.
He is one of the best 17 up there. They've lost seven in a row now. If it was picked on form, I think he would be there, with all due respect. But in Brian Smith's defence, he is doing what coaches do. They make tough decisions. If you make decisions based on popularity, you will fail. Mm. The real test, as we've said before on this program, is next year when Brian Smith's new look side comes together and how successful that will be.
And he's been given the next 12 months. And I mean, that's one of the greatest sayings I've ever heard in coaching. And I think Wayne Bennett says it often. The moment you start listening to the crowd, you'll end up sitting with them.
Just briefly, boys, are you happy with the way the media are covering this thing? It's very...
Over the top. There's agendas in there, but that always is the case. And, you know, I would imagine Brian Smith and his players are looking forward to the off-season to get ready for next year.
Stay fired up, because I'm about to hop onto your team. I'm opposed to you here, but I'm hopping onto your team on the corner post, because I want to bash up this bloke in between us. Friday night. It's not the most classic example of a corner post, the corner post rule being a problem in the game, but Sonny Bill Williams got away, and we're examining to see if he actually touched the corner post before he grounded the ball. Now, while I say this as an example is only light, Gus, I think today we have exhibit B, C, D that basically puts an end to the corner post.
His body was out before he hit the corner post.
Well, it may well have been, but they ruled it on that vision that he'd hit the corner post. They never went back to look at his legs on the sideline. He was probably out anyway. Yep. But the ball got down and his arm was resting against the corner post above the ground.
Yes.
I say the corner post is irrelevant
in
the grounding of the ball.
Leave it there, man. Leave it there, but the rules governing in and out of play on the corner post are wiped. Now, let's go to Newcastle. Gus, pick it up. Show us what happened up in Newcastle with the corner post.
Some very interesting footage here of corner post analysis. What we have is a corner post. We want to show you where the corner post is in this occasion. It's actually in the field of play. It's not even out on the sideline. Whoever put that corner post up is either cross-eyed or doesn't know where it goes.
And he was fired.
Now, he could actually be in the field of play and touch against that corner post and it'd be ruled no try.
Yes.
Now, out of this incident, the defending player will knock the corner post down. The complaint will go on and it'll knock the corner post down.
And now 6 minutes
later, a try is scored in that corner. Where's the corner post?
The corner post was down, Matty.
It's laying on the ground. No one picked it up. No one cared. What if his arm was above it there like Sonny Bill? They said, well, look, it didn't touch the corner post.
Explain, Matty.
Explain.
Explain that. How is it even relevant when people stood aside and let a poor damn corner post lie on the ground?
It was like a dead soldier.
No one cared. An assassin shot it from the grassy knoll. It's lying on the deck.
It's just one of those things that sometimes it's like advertising. When it's not there, you notice it a lot more. And I think when the game was a far lesser spectacle without the corner post being there. Guys, I'll say it again. I've said it many times. I hear people say it all the time. It's becoming a cliche. Rugby league without a corner post is like badminton without a shuttlecock. And I'll just leave it there.
That's what they're all saying. All righty, I just say that there you go. Corner post was down on the deck. It's in the ground. It's a joke. Corner post is a joke.
To stay. To stay.
Okay, fair enough. The lone voice, MG.
You can leave it there, but it doesn't matter. If you touch it, it doesn't matter. It's a lighthouse. It's a lighthouse for the people. The other one's for just to let people know where the angles of the field are.
All right, now, I mentioned Cooper Vuna in that. A few weeks ago, we showed you highlights of Cooper Vuna's first press conference where he said absolutely nothing. But he came up with a try on Friday night that staggered us. Suddenly, Cooper Vuna thought he was a 150-kilo sumo wrestler.
What about the...
Who can run?
What about the Kiwi sidestep you put on there?
Yeah, he salutes the Cooper Vuna stand there, and it was absolutely fantastic. So, Cooper Vuna, well done.
Well done.
Magnificent. Yeah,
good stuff.
Another shot at embattled Knights coach Brian Smith. Newcastle stalwart Jack Newton says Andrew John's legacy at the club has been lost because his former teammates have all been punted.
I think with the radical changes he's made, he's probably got to the middle of the next year or next season, and if it's not working, then he should be shown the door.
Unwanted forward Kirk Reynoldson and his manager met with Knights officials today to discuss a settlement of his dispute with the club. Reynoldson has again been left out of the first grade side for the final round.
And in Newcastle, just when all seemed lost between the Knights and Kirk Reynoldson, they're back on speaking terms, hoping to avoid court action. Danny Widler, National 9 News.
Time for sport now with Matthew White, and the dramas continue in Newcastle.
Not over yet, but one thing is clear. Kirk Reynoldson's career at the Knights is finished. And coming up, why the captain could be the next one to go.
Our club's just been shaken.
The team list for the final round of footy have revealed the harsh realities of rugby league. Retiring veteran David Peachey has been left out of the top grade for the Rabbitohs versus the Roosters, while Kirk Reynoldson has again been overlooked by Newcastle and is now negotiating a payout with the club. And Knights skipper Danny Bedeiros has revealed he's no certainty to stay.
Danny Bedeiros won't lie. These have been some of his toughest times.
Yeah, definitely. It's on a lot of levels. Our club's just been shaken, and there's been a lot of different things that go into that that doesn't make it a happy place.
As captain, he wants to help the Knights back to the top, but after the Kirk Reynoldson saga, admits even with 2 years to go on his contract, there's no guarantees.
As far as I'm concerned, I'm here, but if there's an attractive offer from UK or an opportunity where it's in the club's best interest, in my best interest, I guess you'd probably look at it.
Reynoldson held fresh talks aimed at a payout, but his teammates say he should be in the side.
Yeah, 100%. I think there's no doubt that he's good enough to be in the team.
Coach Brian Smith is holding firm, even though John Singleton, Jack Newton and a group of Knights supporters are unhappy.
While the White Knights admit it's a myth to say they have the power to force any change, they are seeking a meeting with Newcastle bosses to express their disappointment at the direction of the club.
I'm sure Brian will be here until, next year, and by the middle of the year, if things haven't turned around, this place will be after his head.
Let's take a look at their opponents, the Newcastle Knights, who, as I said, are on the road. Steve Simpson back after 1 week sideline with injury into the second row. Corey Patterson shuffled to a five-man bench. Daniel Abraham named in the second row, plays game 100. There is no Kirk Reynoldson, a five-man bench there. Now, press release today from the Newcastle Knights. It reads, the Knights' Kirk Reynoldson and his advisor Les Ross held a positive meeting today at the club's headquarters. It was agreed dialogue will continue and both parties will work towards a mutually beneficial outcome. It ends. Not quite sure exactly what that means, but I think you'll find neither party wants to go to court, which is the right action.
Exactly right. And I think both of them would like an end to it all. I know Kirk Reynoldson, he's been quite upset by the situations at Newcastle and feels a bit responsible for the way the team's gone. It's probably a bit tough on him, and the club's obviously trying to make plans for the future. So it's a really uncomfortable situation. And I think the Knights will be just happy to get this game over and done with and start planning for next year.
OK, a Tigers victory makes it pretty nervous on a couple of other sides. Can the Knights beat them on Friday night?
I think they'll struggle. I think their form's been pretty poor, and obviously with what's gone on off the field has certainly affected them. And like I said, I think the Tigers, with the side they've got on paper, and you know, if Farrah's fit, I think they're going to be too good for the night.
The contrite Andrew Johns admits he was arrested for possessing ecstasy in London. Rugby league legend Andrew Johns is in disgrace tonight after being arrested in London for possessing ecstasy. The retired star admits he had a tablet in his jeans, but insists it was put there by a stranger.
Andrew Johns back in Australia and trying to repair the damage to his reputation. The retired rugby league legend was arrested in London on Sunday afternoon after leaving an all-day nightclub. Transport police targeting revellers at the Notting Hill Festival found an ecstasy tablet in his pocket. He was released after being officially cautioned. In a statement, Johns says he forgot about the tablet after an unknown person put it there. Instead of getting rid of it, he said, "I left myself in a situation I soon deeply regretted." Admitting his disappointed family and young fans, he added, "It has left a black mark on my reputation, which I'll work very hard at erasing." Just how black a mark emerging after the news broke?
Footballers are role models, but in relation to drugs and particularly ecstasy, they are dangerous. And in this state, it could well have led to charges.
Once they sign an autograph, as I say, they're responsible for their actions to the kids and to the game.
But John still remains a hero to many in his hometown Newcastle, his friends and former teammates at the Knights not adding to the controversy. But others have no sympathy given his profile with young fans.
From what I understand, he was quite a role model, so I think he's just buying that a little bit.
Joey Johns has been somebody that everybody has looked up to. It sends a dreadful message to young people in particular.
By accepting a simple caution, Johns escapes a criminal conviction, but it will be recorded on the police database and may be used should he face any future offence in Britain. After holidaying in Europe, Johns was expected to conduct training sessions with the Wallabies ahead of the Rugby World Cup. Any chance of that immediately dismissed by the ARU when news broke this morning. In Newcastle, Eddie Meyer, 10 News.
More on another story we brought you earlier. NRL boss David Gallop says Andrew Johns' reputation and the game will be potentially damaged by his London drug arrest for possession of ecstasy. The NRL say there's no action they can take against Johns, but he's still a very important role model for the game. Gallop says Johns will face wider scrutiny.
He says it was pushed into his back pocket, the ecstasy pill. Are you giving him any benefit of the doubt?
Well, that explanation's clearly going to come under some scrutiny, but I'll leave it to him to talk more about that.
Are you buying into it?
As I say, that explanation's going to come under scrutiny.
But the NRL have accepted John's apology as genuine and hope he's learned a lesson. In the wake of Andrew Johns' ecstasy dramas in London, the Wallabies have confirmed they won't be employing him as a consultant at the World Cup. The team arrived in Paris to hear the startling news of Johns' arrest.
An evening journey to a nearby art museum, capping off a memorable opening day in France. But there was still one big major surprise in store.
Following the team's visit to the museum, 10 News informed Wallabies management that Andrew Johns had been arrested for possession of ecstasy. The Australian Rugby Union was quick to distance itself from the former rugby league star, saying that he's never been contracted to the ARU and, in light of recent events, will not play any part in this current World Cup campaign. In Paris, Rob Canning, 10 News.
I was stupid. League great Andrew Johns facing an uncertain future following his ecstasy arrest.
Hope it doesn't ruin his reputation.
To other news now, and the stellar career of Andrew Johns is in turmoil tonight following revelations he'd been arrested in London for possessing the drug ecstasy. His future as a freelance coach is now in doubt, with the Wallabies today shutting the door on Johns making any contribution to their World Cup campaign.
Andrew Johns flew into Sydney this afternoon for talks with the Nine Network. He was in no mood to face the cameras or answer any questions about his arrest. Johns returned from a European vacation in disgrace. He was one of 206 people arrested for drug possession last Sunday after the annual Notting Hill Carnival. Johns claims an unknown person pushed a tablet into the pocket of his jeans whilst at the church all-day club.
The story he's told, is he sticking to that?
Yeah, the statement he put out this morning had a lot of his measurement in there.
Well, that explanation's clearly going to come under some scrutiny.
John said, "I stupidly forgot about the tablet, and instead of getting rid of it,
I left myself in a situation I soon deeply regretted.
Are drugs an issue at all for Andrew Johns? Is it something you've had to deal with him before about, or is it this come as a complete shock to you?
This is the first and only issue that that I've dealt with Andrew.
He apologised to his fans, but that didn't wash with everyone.
I note that he's made an apology. Footballers are role models, but in relation to drugs, and particularly ecstasy, they are dangerous. And in this state, it could well have led to charges.
The NRL's highest profile player, Willie Mason, said Johns shouldn't be tarnished for one slip-up.
You know, one mistake from him shouldn't have to cost his career after football, because he's been such a great role model for the kids over the years, and he doesn't deserve this, and I'm just hope it doesn't ruin his reputation.
Johns will tell the full story of his arrest on The Footy Show tonight, where he'll be interviewed by his former New South Wales Origin coach, Phil Gould. Danny Widler, National 9 News.
Tonight, in a Footy Show exclusive, Andrew Johns' drugs controversy. His words, the whole story, live and exclusive, only on The Footy Show tonight, 9:30.
Channel 9.
Andrew Johns' media career under review over his London drug arrest. Andrew Johns' post-football career is under threat tonight after London police arrested him for carrying an ecstasy pill. The former Knights captain blames a stranger, but he's paying the price, with a Wallabies coaching deal ruled out and a media contract under review.
He retired a hero, but the halo has slipped for Andrew Johns after the father of one was arrested in London. Johns had been partying at the church and was caught by police with an ecstasy pill when searched at King's Cross Station. He claims an unknown person pushed it into his jeans at the nightclub, saying in a statement, "I stupidly forgot about the tablet, and instead of getting rid of it, I left myself in a situation I soon deeply regretted." Fans aren't buying his excuse.
I think people who are caught with drugs are some way connected with it.
I know what goes in my pockets, and I don't see why he shouldn't see what goes in his pockets.
That explanation's going to come under scrutiny, but we'll leave it to him to talk a bit more about that.
I think you could drive a truck through his explanation, and it's certainly something that we'll be looking at today.
While his newspaper column's under a cloud, there's no comment from the Nine Network, where Johns was being groomed as one of their faces of rugby league.
But the Wallabies haven't wasted any time. Australian Rugby Union boss John O'Neill says Johns will no longer be involved in the team's World Cup campaign.
Under UK law, Johns wasn't charged, but the arrest goes down on his police record.
Footballers are role models, but in relation to drugs, and particularly ecstasy, they are dangerous. And in this state, it could well have led to charges.
Patrick Mullahan, 7 News.
Andrew Johns, live tonight, explains all, tells all, on The Footy Show.
Looking forward to that one. Good on you, Ken. Okay. Thank you.
Their drug and alcohol-fueled scandals have never been worse. Martin King looks at what's going on, and more importantly, what's being done to stop it.
We have is basically the new black.
It's sort of saying that he's right to take drugs, but no, it's not.
Nine News revealed last night Sailor tested positive to a recreational drug.
It would be a little bit naive to think that recreational drugs aren't involved in all types of sport.
Johns on his left foot.
Andrew Johns has reportedly been arrested in London for drug possession.
Sailor! They're the rock stars of footy, and they get paid squeals. They're fated and famous, and the heroes of millions. But with great power comes great responsibility, which has left some of our stars dropping the ball. And now rugby league great Andrew Johns caught in possession of ecstasy, one tablet, in London.
Kevin Walters,
ex-Brisbane Bronco, says times have changed a lot since he pulled on a boot.
I've got some concerns. I'm coaching a team in the Queensland Cup here in Brisbane. And I have got some concerns, definitely, with recreational drugs. But, I think it's about education of the players, and trying to steer them in the right path rather than an option where they may take drugs, which would obviously not the best or smartest move to make at this stage in their careers.
Andrew Johns is to rugby league what a Nathan Buckley or Ben Cousins is to AFL. He's arguably the greatest player the game has ever seen, and therefore he is a role model to thousands, hundreds of thousands of kids.
Rebecca Wilson is a columnist with the Sydney Sunday Telegraph. She's also a mother.
For me, with teenage sons, a mum with teenage sons, I've got to explain to my teenage sons, well, it's still not okay, actually, to take ecstasy or to sniff cocaine. But that's a difficult thing when they're seeing these guys who do put themselves up in positions of really great power in terms of the effect and impact they have on kids as people are doing the wrong thing.
And Andrew Johns will appear exclusively on the Nine Network's NRL Footy Show tonight at 9:30.
Tonight on The Footy Show, Andrew Johns live. The whole story, the real story. A troubled Johns talks exclusively to his old Origin coach and mentor, Phil Gould. And brother Matthew has his say. Then in the fight for the finals, will South Sydney crash the party? And a do-or-die eel, Nathan Hindmarsh, he joins the panel. Plus live and loud with Knowlesy. Plus we've got more from league's best-looking blokes. It's all that and a whole load more. This is The Footy Show. Please welcome your host, our very own super mega league legend, Paul the Batman Vorton. Here he is.
G'day, thanks for joining us. Hello everyone at home. It's a big show tonight. Of course, this weekend we'll see round 25 of the top eight will finally be decided, and those teams on the brink like the West Tigers and the Brisbane Broncos have massive games this weekend. Also talking tonight to Nathan Hindmarsh from the Eels. They've lost three in a row. We're going to see what happens to them on the weekend. They take on Brisbane. The boys are all here on the panel. Hello boys, good to see you. And Shannon Knoll tonight sings a brand new song, a world exclusive for the Footy Show tonight. Look forward to listening to him. He's actually a big Sharkies fan as well, Shannon Knoll. Now, in case you missed the news, on the weekend, Andrew Johns was caught in possession of an ecstasy tablet. He has since flown home from London to Australia and is here live tonight exclusively to talk to the Footy Show with his old mentor and good friend, Phil Gould.
Thank you, Fatty. Naturally, I'd like to be here under much better circumstances, Andrew. Andrew Johns being arrested in London in possession of an ecstasy tablet, that's a big story. But listening to Talkback Radio today and public opinion, most of it has surrounded the excuse that was delivered this morning by way of a press statement, that an unknown person had planted this or put it into your pocket and you didn't realise it was there or you forgot it was there. Most people just don't buy that. Can you understand their thinking?
Yeah, totally. I can understand it, but yeah, I'll stand by it. I left the place and someone came up and just, I don't know whether they handed it to me or put it in my pocket, and then I got caught with it. Look, I put my hand up. I was going to take it.
Just explain where you'd been that day and how you actually come to get the tablet in your possession.
I'd been at a place called The Church where a lot of Australians and New Zealanders go, and obviously been there for 4 or 5 hours and had a few beers. And then I was leaving and then an unknown person come up and just sort of come up to me in a crowded area. And then I don't know if he put it in my pocket or put it in my hand, but it was in my pocket. As I said, I forgot all about it. I put my hand up. I knew what he was giving me. And, you know, I was in the wrong.
When you say an unknown person, you'd never seen this person before?
Never.
And you accepted a tablet off him. Did you know what it was when you took it?
Of course I knew.
You knew it was ecstasy when you took it? When you took it off him and put it in your pocket, did you intend to use it?
Yeah.
You intended to use it?
Yeah.
When you were arrested, how did you get from there to being picked up by police?
We went on the tube and I didn't have a ticket, so I was at the train station. And there was a couple of Australian girls and they just said, come through on our pass. And they sort of waved their things over the scanner and I snuck through, went on the tube for a few, I don't know how many stations, but got off. And when I got off, I went to go through with her, and when I looked up, there was, you know, a dozen police there. So I actually asked the policeman, where do you buy a ticket at?
So good move.
Yeah, great move. So when I went to buy the ticket, they obviously searched me and found the ecstasy tablet.
All right, and from that point, you were arrested,
yep.
Handcuffed,
yep.
Put in jail.
Yep.
How long were you in jail?
About 6 hours, I think.
What was that like?
Probably the the scariest moment of my life.
What was it like? Were you with other people in there?
I was in a cell of my own, but you know, in the other cells there was a couple of crazy men just running and charging into the walls and screaming out constantly, and it really shook me up. It was really scary.
Did you think at this time that you were going to be charged with a drug offence?
Yeah.
Or were they always saying that it was going to be a caution?
No. They asked when I was going home, and I said, hopefully the next day. And they sort of shook their head and said I was a silly boy. And then, I thought I'd, you know, be charged and then go, you know, to court later that week or something.
Just go back to actually getting the tablet. You say you never met this bloke before, you didn't know who he was, you knew it was ecstasy,
yeah.
You put it in your pocket and you intended to use it later.
Yeah.
That would suggest to me, if you knew what it was and you intended to take it, that you had taken, you know, drugs before.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Yeah, it's correct. It's happened before. People have come to me and put, you know, give me ecstasy before.
You've only been retired from rugby league 4 months. So am I to assume that you were still taking drugs when you're playing days? I mean, does it go back that far?
Yeah.
How far?
Probably 10 years. Yeah, probably 10 years. I've taken on and off, generally during the off-season, but there's times when during the season I've run the gauntlet and played Russian roulette and taken it.
I've known your drinking habits. You know, and football had a drinking culture when you first came into rugby league. So you're saying for 10 or 12 years of this illustrious career that you were in the grip of drug and alcohol. Do you call it dependency or do you call it...
No, I wouldn't say I was in drug dependency. I do it occasionally. I was, you know, I think I had an alcohol problem, but it was more in the off-season I'd do it just
can
as
you, can
a release.
Can you remember when you started? Can you first remember when you felt I need to take recreational drugs?
I was about 19, 20, 21 when I first started it. And to be honest, I sort of used it to escape all the pressure and stuff.
Well, that was my next question. Why? I mean, why do you take it? People won't wear that. People won't wear that. What do you, when you say you escape, what are you escaping from? Being Andrew Johns?
Well, just probably the pressure involved. And look, it's not all black and white. There's other areas too, you know. There's medical reasons and that contribute to my, my reckless behaviour. But, you know, I don't want to make excuses. I put my hand up. I've done the wrong thing. And, I'm so ashamed of it. But there's no excuses.
So how regular is he? I mean, you're playing top-class football. You're regarded as one of the best, if not the best of all time. We've seen the football that you played, yet you're telling us at regular intervals you've bashed yourself up with recreational drugs.
During the year?
During the year?
No, during the year it happened only a couple of times. And, you know, people probably ask, how do you avoid the drug testers? Well, you know, if you play a Friday night and you don't train on a Saturday, Sunday, then generally it's out by Monday.
How do you... How did you live with that lie?
I've lived with it for 10 years. It just adds to the paranoia and, you go out Friday night, you go out and you sort of hammer yourself and then you don't know where you've been for 2 days. It can really get down.
Was this a need? I mean, did you feel the need to have this drug to get away from whatever pressure it was you're feeling, or was it... Just for the sake of having a good time.
I don't know what it was. It was, you know, during the year when I was playing, some years I went the whole season without touching it. And then in the off season, I'd do it. But then there's a couple of times during the season when I would take it.
Did you look forward to taking it? I mean,
yeah.
Was it in the back of your mind the whole time, I can't wait for my next time?
You know, there was times when I'm playing the biggest games of the season, and it'd be in the back of my mind.
2003, prior to the Origin series that year, I was the coach, you were the player, and it was publicised at that time that you and I had had a falling out, when in fact we hadn't. You'd told me at that time that you were sick of rugby league and wanted to quit. This is back in 2003.
Yeah.
And you were stressed, you were under pressure, and we in fact spoke about it pretty heavily at that time. And you felt that living at Newcastle in this fishbowl and the Andrew Johns, the high profile bloke, you couldn't deal with it anymore. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
How often did you feel like that? I mean, is that the escape you were looking from? Is it the expectation, the profile, the pressure?
You know, my life's been great, and you know, I think everyone at home would realise how lucky I am, but you know, the pressure's involved. It's not until I finished that I realised just how much pressure I was under. You know, whether I use that for an escape or not, but as I said, mate, there's other factors which were involved with it, but probably mostly it was just all the pressure and stuff, yeah.
The bloke getting up going to work,
yeah,
7 days a week, earning his $50,000 to put food on the table, he doesn't understand Andrew Johns, with all this money and all this talent, needs to escape from that sort of life. I mean,
I know, I couldn't blame him. You know, I think people like that have to get up and work the long hours and earn that sort of money to pay their mortgage off.
The people closest to you, you know, your family, your brother, your parents, did they know?
Yeah, I think so.
Your football club, did they know?
I'd say so, on occasions.
Your teammates?
Yep.
The media? Was there anyone in the media who knew this secret?
Well, there's always rumours, I think.
All right, we might take a break. When we come back after the break, I'm going to talk to Andrew Johns about the NRL and its drug-taking policy and the effect that this has had on him and his family. Be back after the break. Reach for a new beginning. A brand new day is coming round the bend. Troubles reaching for the end. And if you stray, welcome back to the Footy Show, talking with Andrew Johns. Andrew, before the break, you mentioned a couple of times that depression was a big thing in your life, and you also said there's medication and conditions. Can you elaborate on that? I mean, do you take medication for depression?
I sort of have for the last 5 years or so.
Constantly, during that time?
Yeah, pretty constant.
Who diagnosed that for you?
Club doctors and a professor here in Sydney. About sort of 6 or 7 years ago, but originally I never didn't want to take it because it stabilised me and took away, I suppose, these incredible highs I got on. But you know, invariably after the highs, I'd crash to lows where I wouldn't leave the house for 4 days.
I didn't get to see you all that often in person. I mean, we might talk every now and then, but I've got to say, mood swings were a part of your character.
Yeah.
You had...
And it contributed to the way I behave, you know. It could be a matter of days. 1 minute I could be, you know, literally willing to take the world on. And that's when I was at my creative best, when I'd be playing. But then one day, you know, I can turn up the field and wouldn't want to talk to anybody.
Were the mood swings brought on by the drug taking, or was the drug taking because of the mood swings?
No, I've had it for a while.
It's remarkable to me that you can say for the last 10 or 12 years you've had this drug taking, you know, and fairly regularly, as you say. The NRL claims to have a stringent drug testing policy. How many times in your career, in those 12 years, were you actually drug tested?
I'd say, you know, 2 or 3 times a year.
So we're talking, yeah. 25, 30 times?
Yeah.
25, 30 times in your career you're drug tested,
yeah.
Yet you're frequently using. How do you don't get caught?
Well, not frequently using during the year. I'd use it occasionally during the year when I was playing. I spoke before of playing Russian roulette. This was like sometimes to take it and then feel like I was on the borderline. Maybe I could go positive, maybe I could go negative. And scrape through.
Wasn't that a warning?
It was a warning.
You actually took drug tests and you thought, I could fail this.
Yeah.
How were you for the next...
It's funny, you know, you see other players and I see mates who have gone positive and you think, you know, I'd hate to be in this situation. I can't imagine how humiliating and embarrassing and, you know, it would be for yourself. But until it's you in front of the paper with your head there, you know, I can't describe how humiliating it is for not only you but your family.
I don't know whether you will or whether you can answer this question, but is this just you? Is this rife in rugby league? Are there more players who are playing Russian roulette with the drug system?
Well, I don't know. I don't answer.
You don't know or you don't want to answer?
Well, I don't know and I don't want to answer.
So you've never seen drug use in other players? Is that what you're saying?
Well, I don't want to. You know, I'm here to talk about myself, not other players.
All right, well, don't call it rugby league players. Call it society. You're a young bloke, you're out about town all the time. What about in society? How prevalent is drug use in nightclubs and all the places you frequent?
Well, it's everywhere you go in nightclubs.
That's the honest part of it. It's everywhere. So if footballers are out everywhere, then it's only wise to assume that footballers are exposed to this all the time.
Yeah, I wouldn't tar everyone on the same brush. Right.
So since 1999, there have been five NRL players suspended because of recreational drug positive tests. We get a fellow like Ben Cousins in the AFL, big name. Shane Warne, big name. Wendell Saylor, big name. Craig Field at the time, big name. They go positive. You sit back and look at the headlines. What are you thinking?
I remember thinking how easy that could have been me. It's, you know, it's had so many close calls. And I spoke about it before. You think about the humiliation you put on yourself, not only yourself, your family. But it's not until you wake up in the morning and realise that you're the one on the front of the paper that it, like, you know, I haven't slept in days, I haven't eaten. I just can't describe how bad I felt, you know, sitting there this morning trying to explain to my 7-year-old son what I'd done in London, you know.
I'll come back to that in a minute. I can't understand, and this is what I can never understand about footballers, and you're not the only one that I've ever spoken to about this, trust me. And you're not the only one to ever go positive, trust me. But when you sign a contract that says, I will not do drugs, when you have so much to risk, your family, your contract, your money, your future, your reputation, what drives you to say, well, I'll still give it one more go?
I've got no idea. You know, for me, the problem was alcohol. I would never intentionally go to take drugs. But then, you know, I'd have 6 or 8 beers and then I just wouldn't care.
You talked about the headlines, and I remember as a coach I would bring headlines in when this would happen, and I'd tell my players, just imagine your photo alongside these headlines. This morning it's your picture in the paper alongside those drug headlines. How do you feel when you see that it's you now?
Well, it's hard to put into words. In a way, you know, I can deal with it being me, but my family, what they have to put up with, you know, my partner's family. And I spoke before, but I had to sit down and tell my son before he went to school today about what went on. It just...
Was that tough? I mean, I know it's tough talking to your 7-year-old son. I probably don't even want you to answer this. If it's tough for you to sit down and explain to your 7-year-old son why Dad's in the paper on drug charges, how do you think, or what have you exposed him to when he goes to school tomorrow? I mean, can you get your head around what you've now done to him? Can players out there appreciate that their kids also live with the stigma or what kids will say in school about their dad?
Well, it surprised me just how much, you know, he knew as a 7-year-old. And, you know, it's just incredible selfish behaviour when you think about it.
It's timely. Every household in Australia this week has got something from the government, from the National Drugs Campaign, about talking with your kids about drugs. It's every parent's fear. I've got kids. We've all got kids. We all worry about the day our kids are going to be exposed to the temptation of drugs. Do you understand how difficult it is for people to deal with this and deal with talking to their kids about drugs when high-profile people keep legitimising it, whether it be movie stars or actors or rock concert or sportsmen? What do you say to the parents about their kids and what this has done?
Well, you know, my past 10 or 12 years has been like a fairy tale. And, you know, I've been so lucky of experienced so much, but I think about some of the great times I've had and they've just been destroyed because I've taken drugs. You know, I look back now and, you know, I'm so ashamed of it. It just, it's destroyed some of the great times in my life.
Where do you go from here? Where do you go from here? I mean, I said to you today that, you know, this won't be the end of the world. You're only human and you'll get over this. We all make mistakes, you know, and I put my hand up, we've all made mistakes in our lives. Where do you go from here? And I said to you that maybe your great playing career, and this has happened to you, maybe this is the reason you're here. Can you see a positive in you becoming a campaigner, an advocate, or the face of drug reform, or to help parents, footballers, clubs, with the embarrassment that you're feeling now? Is there a way for you to get a positive out of this? Is it something you want to do, or do you want to run away from it?
No, I'd like to somehow influence young people or young players. Now, this is the road you don't want to go down. You know, I'm confident, well, I know I'll never touch a drug again. The way I felt, you know, being handcuffed, being in that London lockup in the jail, it's just a feeling I can't describe, you know. I'll never go near it again.
You actually said to me today that in a way it's a relief. This is now an excuse to stop. I know this is hard for you tonight. I know it's the last couple of days. This isn't going to go away. It'll be with you forever. But is there some way that you see it's a relief now? It's out in the open. I can get on with it, and I can not do it again.
Well, it's a clean slate. You know, I've lived with this. I feel like it's a lie I've lived for a long time, and I've been so ashamed of it. But now it's all out in the open. You know, I wouldn't say it's glad it's happened. You know, I can't say that, but with what's happened, you know, I've got to take something out of it. I'd be a mug otherwise. And if it means I'll never touch it again, so be it. But to influence other people, I think that's maybe the greatest thinking I'm out of it.
All right, mate. Very brave tonight. Thanks for your time, and thanks everyone for your time as well.
Well, thanks to Phil Gould and the very honest Andrew Johns there. It was riveting viewing, and Matt, I know you've done it tough watching that, as has Chief and MG. You've been aware of this problem. When you heard the news that Matt had been arrested, Andrew had been arrested, you got a phone call during the week to say you'd been arrested for having drugs on him. What were your first thoughts?
To be honest, Fatty, I think tonight everyone got an insight into probably how unstable Andrew's life has been over the last 10 to 12 years. And a lot of that stuff, we've, rightfully or wrongfully, we've sort of kept to ourselves, you know, his ups and downs and whatnot. And I'll be honest with you, when it was actually Brian Carney, he rang me from Ireland, and someone had called him and said that, Andrew, it was 3:30 in the morning, he rang and he said, mate, I've got some bad news on Joey. And knowing Andrew and his reckless behaviour, I thought he was dead. I thought this is the phone call I've been waiting for. And to be honest, when he told me he'd been arrested for drugs, sounds strange, but I was relieved.
Do you think, with what you've seen tonight, Andrew's put his hand up, admitted to all these things, will he be a changed man now?
You know, it's only Andrew can answer that. Yeah. You know, I'm proud of him tonight. It was awful this morning, you know, with the media statement. I knew he was a better man than that. But to come on and face up to the truth, take responsibility. And, you know, did we know about it? As Joey said, you know, we probably did, Fatty. To what extent, I don't know. Probably knew the full extent. Probably didn't have the guts to act, mate, you know. So, you know, I'd take certain responsibility in there as well. But, you know, if his arrest means that he never touches a drug again, well, man, it's you know, I think it's a real positive. It's a good thing, Fatty.
And Chief, you played all your career with Andrew Johns. I know you did it tough watching that. What are your thoughts?
Well, my thoughts is, you know, life is a drama of ups and downs. You know, the world's greatest rugby league player behind the scenes, which most people don't know, has struggled through on a lot of different avenues, and it's a struggle that's been tough. And, you know, I've always worried about Joey when he'd retire and how things would turn out. But I'll say this, is that Joey, no matter what football game it is or whatever, he always lifts. And tonight, under tremendous pressure, he lifted again and told the truth, and he's free.
Well said. Well said, Pete. And gee, I mean, you were in a similar boat many, many years ago.
Yeah, I you know, back in 91, had the misfortune of testing positive to marijuana, and the thing about it is that it's the first step now that he's made that. Now he's got to go out to schools, he's got to preach to kids in particular. He's got to really ram home the fact that drugs and sport and anything don't mix. And I commend him what he's done to come in. That's a very brave thing to do. But now it all begins. Now the rest of his life begins, as Matty says. Hard thing to do.
All right, you're watching The Footy Show. After this break, Shannon Knoll's got a brand new single out, and Nathan Hindmarsh joins us to talk about the Parramatta Eels. See you in a minute. Welcome, Hindy.
Thanks,
good to
mate.
See you, champ. Now, you're a good mate of Andrew Johns. What are your thoughts on what you witnessed tonight?
Yeah, I can understand the what he said about the pressure. You know, it does get tough, and especially someone like Andrew Johns, who's, you know, I think it's the best player in the game, and to start there week in, week out, it is a lot of pressure, and, you know, your fans want to see it from you each week, and I understand it gets tough.
Welcome back to The Footy Show. That's gold. And, guys, I want to tell you the drummer. Her name is Aisha Khan, because you were asking last week about it, and I just sort of
quite
let you know it took me 12
weeks. What her name was?
I've got some big news, everyone. Are you ready? Are you sure you're ready? I've reached number one. That's it.
Are you top of the charts?
Top of the charts, yeah. Wow. That's gold. You can see Shannon Knowles come in second there. That's on the big W.
Big
best
W.
Oh,
yeah. The big W. So it's not the ARIA charts
it's the big
W. The big W charts.
Yeah, over the weekend I sold more than anyone else on
big
W. You've
got to sell six copies to get on top
that?
Of that.
No, mate, it's number one. Big W is great.
Does anyone buy their music from Big W?
I'll tell you what,
from Big W.
I'll tell you what, though.
Do they?
Oh,
and books. Very good.
I kind of feel that I've got to have more of a mentoring role now that I'm number one. I did have a yarn to Shannon out the back there about a few things, and it was good. I kind of said to him things like, you know, your single's name Loud. I probably would have called it Louder or Loudest or Bloody Loud, just to give it a bit more of a pack. A couple little tips like that, but I'm feeling good about where things are going.
Okay?
It's
good. I'll tell you, I've got something that'll make you feel even better. We got some emails through from lots of fans, Chief. Got a whole new fan base. This one's from... the start says it all. To the love of my life, big Chiefy boy. It's from a guy named Curtis. And true story, they're out there.
Hey, a boy's name's Kurt. Curtis is a girl's name.
Mate, it's a bloke called Curtis. I'm a 23-year-old Capricorn and I do emotions for you. Remember, this is a man. I'm writing this letter to express my deepest feelings and emotions for you, Chief. Every Thursday, I love watching you on my huge TV. It's just like sitting in front of you're sitting in front of me. It is great. I just love your new single. I play it every night before I go to bed. It soothes me, if you know what I mean. I think you might be talking about masturbation there, Chief. There you go.
That'll do, mate.
If you want,
what time is it?
If you want to get in touch with me, email me at cheesemyman@hotmail.com. Can't wait to hear from you. Now, Curtis. Mate, seriously, if you're out there, give us a call on Channel 9 reception, Channel 9 at Sydney.
Why would you say that? Why do you want Curtis?
And mate, we'll put you through. Yeah. And so if you can ring us, I don't know what the phone number is, but call us.
If he rings, I'll brain you.
9906 9999 9906 9999
So you give us a call.
If anyone would like to talk to Chief, call us.
So, and if you can't make the phone, call, ever got a phone, just hop 100 yards down the road, put your thumb out, and I'm sure he'll pick you up. So,
you're there you go, Chief. Listen,
something to keep you awake in the
way. Thanks very much for that. I just got a little bit of housekeeping. Now, the bottom line is we're going very close to getting on the top 10, and we need the official charts come out on Saturday. They finish 5 o'clock tomorrow, so we need everyone to get behind it. I think it's around about $4 or $5 to buy the CD, it's big money. But everyone counts. Remember, we're raising money for a good cause. NIB Health Funds have got involved as well. They're going to throw their weight behind it, and we'll profile those kids that we're going to help out a little bit later on. Sanity.com, you can get on that. You can get on the 9MSN website, and you can download the song. And if you do, you can win an Xbox 360. You can win tickets to the grand final show. It's all happening. It's all through all states, all good record stores. So let's get that gold up there.
Tonight, Joey's shame.
I think about some of the great times I've had, and they've just been destroyed because I've taken drugs.
The league in turmoil after Johns' explosive confession. But first this evening, the bombshell that has rocked rugby league. The stunning admission from its highest profile player, Andrew Johns, that he took drugs during his entire career. The revelations have caused widespread shock and disappointment.
It was as unexpected as it was startling. What had been brushed off with a clumsy excuse in the morning became a shattering confession by evening. Andrew Johns telling the nation he'd used drugs and alcohol for more than a decade.
I've taken on and off, generally during the off-season, but there's times when during the season I've run the gauntlet and played Russian roulette and taken it.
It was easily Joey's lowest point, with admission after admission. The reason, he claims, was the pressure of being dubbed the greatest player the game has seen, causing depression.
I think about some of the great times I've had, and they've just been destroyed because I've taken drugs. You know, I look back now and, you know, I'm so ashamed of it.
The frank interview followed news of John's arrest in London, caught with an ecstasy tablet, landing him in jail for 6 hours.
It really shook me up. It was really scary.
For his brother, the drug arrest was a strange relief.
It was 3:30 in the morning. He rang and he said, mate, I've got some bad news on Joey. And knowing Andrew and his reckless behaviour, I thought he was dead. I thought this is the phone call I've been waiting for.
From fans last night, mixed reactions.
He was pretty cracked up in there, and he wasn't looking very good at all. So it's a pretty gutsy effort.
You know, a lot of these people that are so-called role models had better wake up to themselves and be more responsible.
Across the community today, concern over how far an idol had fallen.
But I was very disappointed. I think he'll be disappointed in himself. It's very important that we face the reality that drugs in sport is a problem.
And that, says the Salvation Army, is why the NRL should drug test every player in the next 24 hours.
I think it'll give a message to a lot of younger people. They have a look, and some of them have seen that interview last night. I think it would be a clear message that the drugs are just unacceptable. They don't do anything for your life, and they can destroy your life.
But dealing with the fallout, it's not something the game's administrators will consider.
No, we're not going to go down that road. So we're not suggesting an increase in tests in the next few weeks.
The NRL says it has already beefed up testing procedures in recent months, but still nagging questions remain about just how rife drug taking is at the elite levels of rugby league. John says his family and fellow players knew about his behaviour.
Perhaps in hindsight, they'll reflect back and think possibly I should have tapped him on the shoulder and basically said, mate, we need to do something here.
But the Knights CEO disputes talk of a cover-up, saying processes were in place to help.
And I'm sure if people had known, they would go through that process, and I hope that over the coming days that I don't find anything different.
Late this afternoon, the Knights doctor admitted he'd been treating John's addictions for the past 5 years. Eddie Meyer, 10 News.
Besides the very public shame of his drug admission, Andrew Johns will also have to cope with the commercial fallout. And he's already been snubbed by the league, left out of its Night of Nights.
Andrew Johns has won the league's highest award a record 3 times, but this year his Dally M's invitation has been torn up. There was little choice, but the NRL boss says Johns won't be cut adrift.
There's no suggestion that the game will abandon him. We'd like to see him get his life back on track.
The NRL claims the scandal is a shock, but within league circles, Andrew John's drug taking was common knowledge.
Are you shocked?
No, because I've known about it for quite a while. And there's a lot of other blokes on it too.
The great thing about it is he's admitted he's got a problem, you know, and that's the first really step.
Somehow, the champion managed to evade a positive drug test for more than a decade. Drug experts say it's a terrible message for children.
All of a sudden, the messages we're giving lack credibility, and that's one thing that we can't afford when it comes to young people and drugs.
The reality hitting Johns when he told his seven-year-old son.
It surprised me just how much, you know, he knew as a seven-year-old. And, you know, it's just incredible selfish behaviour when you think about it.
Of course, the drug scandal could have far-reaching financial ramifications for Andrew Johns. While some sponsors say they will stick by him, others are seriously reviewing their future relationship with the damaged star. Agent Max Markson believes Andrew Johns will pay dearly for his mistake.
Tens of millions of dollars, really. I mean, long-term, tens of millions of dollars.
But lost endorsements will come second to kicking the drug habit. James Boyce, 10 News.
On field tonight at Johns' club, the Knights take on the West Tigers as they try to avoid the dreaded wooden spoon. Adam Hawes is out there at Telstra Stadium for the game. Adam, one of the great tragedies of this whole saga is it seems there's an ever-growing band of people who are well aware that Johns had a drug problem.
Well, Ron, this has been confirmed late today by the Knights club, Dr. Neil Halpin. He's released a statement saying he's been treating Johns for drug and alcohol abuse since 2002 and has even urged him to go on a 12-step program. Now, I can tell you the NRL, this has not gone down well with them. They say if the Knights knew about this, why weren't they informed? There could be a lot more out of that.
Well, in Newcastle, he was treated like an all-out hero. What's the reaction up there?
Ron, it's been the year from hell for Knights fans. They've had all sorts of dramas with Coach Brian Smith, Kirk Reynoldson being shown the door, and not to say Johns' retirement at the start of the year. For many, this is a last straw.
For the unemployment around here and that, everyone looks at the football players as heroes. And then when the young blokes see them taking drugs and everything, they think it's just the norm. So I think he's a bit of a loser myself.
It is a big thing. Everybody expected him to make them win every time. And I think that's a big responsibility.
I think it's crap. Like, think about every young person that lives in Newcastle and goes out and does things. He's 33, he's not old, he knows what's going on. He knows what it does to you, so he's only lying. Like, and it's a whole PR thing to say I'm sorry.
You know, it was a big man for him to come out to say he was on drugs, and we hope he gets off it, you know, and does well. Yeah.
Ron, a sad day for rugby league. Let's just hope other players get the message.
Yes, we hope so. Adam Hawes at Telstra Stadium. The fallout from Andrew John's drug confession. Hear what shocked fans have to say next. And Joey's bombshell, league great Andrew Johns admits to taking drugs, including ecstasy, for his entire career. Experts estimate the tell-all confession could cost him millions in lost endorsements.
And here's what some of you have had to say about Joey Johns and the drug scandal.
I just thought it was really bad that our children had to see a hero in their eyes be doing that sort of thing.
I'm proud of him for coming out and saying what he did and not, you know, shifting the blame to someone else.
Glad he came clean, but wasn't prepared for what he said. Definitely not.
Everyone makes mistakes. That's life. No, I'm not going to hang him for it.
I was a bit disappointed this morning with the way he handled it, but I think he redeemed himself this evening.
I was disgusted because I've got a child who wants to be an NRL player.
Everyone's sort of heard the rumours for as long as I can remember, and it's just good to finally hear it from him.
He's not the only one that wouldn't be doing it.
Yeah.
He just got caught. He's unlucky.
He's only human. That's how I look at it. I am disappointed, but he's only human.
Welcome to sport. The final round of the NRL kicks off tonight with the Bulldogs chasing a top four spot against the Cowboys. And at Telstra Stadium, the West Tigers have to beat the Knights to stay alive for a final spot. Adam Hawes joins us now, and Adam, seemingly overriding all of that, including the late rush for the finals, is the Andrew Johns issue. And the question is, how did he get away with it for so long?
Tim, all you can say is Johns gambled and got lucky. He was drug tested 17 times and passed them all. But there were times, he said, where he thought he was borderline on whether it was going to be positive or negative.
For Andrew Johns, it was his personal game of Russian roulette.
People probably ask, how do you avoid the drug testers? Well, you know, if you play a Friday night and you don't train on a Saturday, Sunday, then generally it's out by by Monday.
John's evading a positive result despite 17 drug tests as people scratch their heads at his incredible luck. The finger inevitably pointed at the Knights.
Your football club, did they know?
I'd say so, on occasions.
There's certainly evidence that officials knew of his problems and rumours of his problems, but there's no evidence and he hasn't suggested that anything was covered up.
The net John slipped through has been tightened, according to Gallup. The code's new illicit drugs policy, introduced just 2 months ago, dictates each club conduct a minimum of 70 tests each year.
Early on, we didn't get as tested as much as we do now. I think it came out that Andrew Johns had been tested 17 times in his career. I think I've been tested 17 times in the last 2 years.
The league community split over what to do with Johns. The league still want him involved in next year's centenary celebrations. Others believe he shouldn't get off that lightly, like AFL's leading player.
I was really horrified when I saw the treatment of Ben Cousin. He looked like a superstar rock star, you know, and was really put up there as if he hadn't done that much wrong.
All players left with this warning.
If you run this risk, then you're a good chance of getting caught. We may not catch you tomorrow or next week or next month or next year, but if you continue to run the risk, then you're a good chance of being caught.
And Tim, we reported earlier that Johns' doctor, Neil Halpin, released a statement saying he's been treating Johns for his drug problems since 2002. Well, the Knights have just released another statement saying Dr. Halpin's comments were as Johns' private doctor and the club wasn't informed of his treatment. It's been quite a day, and I should point out there is a game here tonight, and to top off a wonderful year for the Knights, if they lose, they get the wooden spoon.
Yeah, it's all a bit of a mess. Thanks, Horsey. Adam Hawes at Telstra Stadium.
The ecstasy and the agony, Andrew Johns and the long-term drug abuse that shadowed his brilliant career.
I've run the gauntlet and played Russian roulette.
Brotherly love, Matthew Johns blames himself for not doing more.
No, I didn't do my job.
National 9 News with Mark Ferguson.
Good evening. In what may prove to be a watershed moment for rugby league, one of its greatest stars has crashed back to earth with a TV confession about drug use during his years at the very top of the game. Andrew Johns admitted to cheating the drug testers and destroying some of the best moments of his career as he struggled to cope with the pressure.
Andrew Johns this morning, looking like a fallen hero after dropping one of the biggest bombshells in Australian sporting history. He appeared on Nine's Footy Show to talk about one ecstasy tablet. But it was this confession that was far more shocking.
So am I to assume that you were still taking drugs when you're playing days? I mean, does it go back that far?
Yeah.
How far?
Probably 10 years. Yeah, probably 10 years. I've taken it on and off, generally during the off-season, but there's times when during the season I've run the gauntlet and played Russian roulette and taken it.
And then from arguably the game's greatest player, a stunning admission how he cheated the system.
You know, people probably ask, how do you avoid the drug testers? Well, you know, if you play a Friday night and you don't train on a Saturday, Sunday, then generally it's out by Monday.
And how reckless he became, taking drugs after drinking binges.
I'd have six or eight beers and then I just wouldn't care.
And why did he do it?
Maybe God has come to Marathon.
The strain, he says, of just being Andrew Johns.
To be honest, I sort of used it to escape all the pressure and stuff.
For the 10 years league's biggest role model was taking drugs, his inner circle shared his secret.
The people closest to you, you know, your family, your brother, your parents, did they know?
Yeah, I think so.
Your football club, did they know?
I'd say so, on occasions.
Your teammates?
Yep.
And he didn't hold back about his arrest in London for carrying an ecstasy tablet after a drinking session at this London nightclub.
I left the place and someone came up and just, I don't know whether they handed it to me or put it in my pocket. And then I got caught with it. Look, I put my hand up, I was going to take it.
John spent 6 hours behind bars.
Probably the most, the scariest moment of my life.
And his return to Australia wasn't much better.
You know, I haven't slept in days, I haven't eaten. I just can't describe how bad I felt. You know, sitting there this morning, trying to explain to a 7-year-old son what I'd done in London.
Andrew Johns says after the London experience, he will never touch drugs again.
You know, I look back now and, you know, I'm so ashamed of it. It just destroyed some of the great times of my life.
Mark Burrows, National 9 News.
Andrew Johns' startling confession has exposed another dark secret, a struggle with depression, which caused private agony for his family. Throughout his rise to greatness, they were in turmoil about his mental state. His brother Matthew says they feared he might take his own life.
You don't have to look past Matthew Johns to see how much his brother's drug and alcohol abuse hurt his family. Beyond that pain lay a real fear that Andrew's destructive behaviour over the last decade would cost Johns his life.
You know, the ins and outs of him and his ups and downs and his reckless behaviour. I was waiting for a phone call that he'd seriously harmed himself in the extreme.
So you lived with that fear as well as a brother?
I think we lived with it as a family.
That must be difficult.
It's been very, very difficult for the family.
Especially for a brother who felt it was his role to guide his best mate through life. Matthew says he let him down.
It was gutless of me, you know. I was supposed to be the big brother. I was supposed to step forward and look after him. But there were times, you know, I didn't do my job.
The Footy Show interview took everything out of Andrew Johns. Once he was off air, he was barely keeping it together. But after the ecstasy revelation, it was an interview he had to do.
I think the part of the reason Andrew had to do it tonight was for Mum and Dad, you know. And yeah, they'd been through copped every hit he'd had along the way. They had the fears as well.
John's depression was diagnosed 5 years ago, and it was prescribed medication to even out his moods. That helped him off the field, but not on it.
One game, he just walked around the field with no motivation. I knew what was up, and that was the effect that the medication had on him. It just evened him out so much. And after what he'd been used to, he hated it. He hated that effect.
Matthew is hoping that by bearing his soul last night, Andrew can now get on with the rest of his life.
My biggest thing I hope for is it makes Joey a better man. You know, he comes away from this and he can get some positives out of it and make a difference.
Danny Widler, National 9 News.
The NRL must now tackle some tough questions. Which officials knew about Andrew Johns' drug use, and how did its testing procedures fail? The Newcastle team doctor has admitted that he was aware of the star player's problems, but the NRL claims that despite the rumours, there was no evidence Johns was using drugs.
Under siege, rugby league boss David Gallop trying to handle the Andrew Johns fallout.
It's been a distressing 24 hours, not only for Andrew Johns, but indeed for the game.
Shocked and distressed he may be, but the question remains, how did Johns' drug taking go undetected for so long?
He may well have been the subject of rumour, but not of factual evidence from our understanding.
The Johns bombshell was felt even in the nation's capital.
I hope the Knights community rallies around him and helps him, but let's not kid ourselves. This is a problem and it's got to be tackled with renewed vigour.
The Salvation Army wants all first graders drug tested immediately to lift the suspicion of shame.
And that would put a clear message out, I think, to the community to say, yeah, we're serious about this.
The NRL maintains its new random drug testing program is working, even though Johns underwent just 17 drug tests in his playing career.
I've never suggested that we were 100% watertight.
The Brisbane Broncos have their own strict testing program.
We introduced a very, very strict code of conduct, and we do our own testing now, and we do that 24/7.
Newcastle Knights management is angry. Some in the club knew of John's problem, but kept it secret.
If you ignore something, you condone it, and certainly you don't want people who condone any of that sort of behaviour in your club.
In a startling admission this afternoon, team doctor Neil Halpin confirmed he did know. I have treated Andrew for many years, not only for his football injuries, but I have coordinated the management of his drug and alcohol abuse. Many players, past and present, believe the greatest game of all will now never be the same.
Yeah, I think it's going to, yeah. I suppose, just as you know, the drug testing policy, I think it will get reviewed.
Simon Boder, National 9 News.
Tonight, the shockwave spread from Andrew Johns' confession of career-long drug abuse.
Your football club, did they know?
I'd say so, on occasions.
Your teammates?
Yep.
Embarrassment for the Knights and the NRL with confirmation of a long-running rumour.
Pretty common knowledge around the town.
This is 7 News with Chris Barth.
Good evening. As rugby league's greatest player, Andrew Johns, has thrown the game into its greatest drug crisis with his bombshell confession of a decade of abuse. Tonight, the 7 News team is standing by with coverage of Joey's shock admission in Sydney, reactions from Newcastle, and the NRL's drug testing under attack. First to Robert Avadia at Telstra Stadium, where the Knights play the Tigers tonight. Rob, what's the feeling among fans there?
Well, Chris, oddly enough, clearly some fans are impressed at Andrew Johns' honesty and guts. Many others, though, are appalled, but they certainly all have one thing in common. They're shocked, for especially many of the young fans turning up here tonight. Andrew Johns was their hero and their role model especially as well. And now that is shattered by his own admission that he planned to take ecstasy in London and also the fact he's been doing it his entire career.
Andrew Johns returning this afternoon to the house where he says he would hide in a deep depression, sometimes for days, just like the player he's always been, confessing his dark secret was raw, emotional, uncompromising.
You were still taking drugs when you're playing days? I mean, does it go back that far?
Yeah.
How far?
Probably 10 years. You know, I think I had an alcohol problem. Incredible highs I got on. But you know, invariably after the highs, I'd crash to lows where I wouldn't leave the house for 4 days.
He spoke of his London arrest with ecstasy in his pocket.
And then I got caught with it. Look, I put my hand up, I was going to take it.
Being thrown in jail.
Probably the most, the scariest moment of my life.
Johns admitted to depression and the mood swings of a gifted sportsman with a gifted life.
1 minute I could be, you know, literally willing to take the world on. And that's when I was at my creative best, when I'd be playing. But then one day, you know, I can turn up the field and wouldn't want to talk to anybody.
For Joey's family, it's been hard, then and now.
My family, what they have to put up with. You know, my partner's family. And I spoke before, but I had to sit down and tell my son before he went to school today about what went on.
Humiliating. Painful, but also a relief.
It was 3:30 in the morning. He rang and he said, "Mate, I've got some bad news on Joey." And knowing Andrew and his reckless behaviour, I thought he was dead. I thought this is the phone call I've been waiting for.
The revelations were embarrassing, not just for Andrew Johns, but for the NRL.
How do you avoid the drug testers? Well, you know, if you play a Friday night and you don't train on Saturday, Sunday, then generally it's out by Monday.
And a startling admission that the Newcastle Knights protected their greatest asset.
Your brother, your parents, did they know?
Yeah, I think so.
Your football club, did they know?
I'd say so, on occasions.
Your teammates?
Yep.
Johns now wants to educate others.
Now this is the road you don't want to go down.
Many consider Andrew Johns the greatest player rugby league has seen. Now time will dictate how he's remembered, as a hero turned villain or a flawed but honest sporting genius. Robert Ovadia, 7 News.
Now to Patrick Moloughan at NRL headquarters. And Pat, league bosses admit they heard rumours of his drug taking. Why didn't they act?
Well, Chris, NRL Chief David Gallop says they simply didn't have any proof. Now, while they've promised not to abandon Andrew Johns, with the damage he's caused, you simply wouldn't want to be the next drug cheat caught.
NRL boss David Gallop admits he'd heard the rumours about Andrew Johns' drug taking, but never confronted him. Now both are paying a price.
The whole episode, very disappointing. As I say, he has damaged his reputation as a great in our game, and that has damaged the image of our game.
Johns' admission of long-term abuse has angered other players and raised doubts about league's drug testing policy.
It's very disappointing from that respect that, you know, he's been doing it for quite some time and never been caught.
While Johns' doctor, Neil Halpin, admits treating him for drug and alcohol abuse for 5 years, the club maintains it didn't know, and new boss Steve Burriston's warned heads will roll if there was a cover-up.
if you ignore something, you condone it, and certainly you don't want people who condone any of that sort of behaviour in your club.
I certainly hope it wasn't the case.
Now all Knights players will be asked to come clean.
We will put structures in place that we hope never see a repeat of this.
And the NRL's warned its revamped drug policy could see players tested any time, anywhere.
The fact is the risks that Andrew Johns ran, the Russian roulette that he played, the stakes are now higher.
Johns jumped before being pushed from an official role in next week's Dally M Awards, and some now say this has cost him any hope of being named an immortal.
Quite simply, to be an immortal in this game means that you are the upper epsilon of everything that the game entails, and that's just not playing. And therefore, Joey probably has done himself some pretty much irreparable damage.
Patrick Mullahan, 7 News.
Tonight, the Knights are rethinking a coaching contract they've been negotiating with Andrew Johns. Reporter Matt Carmichael is in Newcastle. Matt, how are fans there feeling?
Well, Chris, in this town, Joey is king, and not even this can change that. Now, many of the fans I've been talking to here say they have heard these rumours, but the confession did still come as a massive shock.
Loyal Knights supporters on their way to Sydney for tonight's game are still coming to terms with his drug admission.
I felt very sorry for him and his brother.
Joey's day of shame was on everyone's mind in this one-team town.
Pretty shocked, actually. He's a good inspiration to all kids and let a lot of people down.
Disappointed, I suppose, but I think he's got to own up to it.
He's made a mistake, who really cares?
Well, still a great, best footy in the world, best footy player.
But for others, it confirmed the dark secret they'd already heard.
Pretty common knowledge around the town. It was just a matter he came out and confirmed all the rumours, mate.
I think it's good. Everyone knows now, but we already knew.
Their local hero's extraordinary confession has prompted the Knights to reconsider a new coaching deal with the club.
We were in the throes of negotiating with his management a further contract going forward. We've got to pull all those issues together and have a think about that.
But the Knights have promised not to desert him, a sentiment shared by the Prime Minister.
I hope the Knights community rallies around him and helps him, but let's not kid ourselves. This is a problem, and it's got to be tackled with renewed vigour.
One thing we do well here in Newcastle is support our own, and he will have the support of the community.
In Newcastle, Matt Carmichael, 7 News.
The Andrew Johns admission has sent shockwaves through other football codes and sparked calls for reform. AFL coaches in Sydney and Brisbane say it's time for tougher action on players who take drugs.
Sparked by the Johns confession, two senior coaches in the nation's biggest football code have made extraordinary outbursts about the AFL's drug culture.
Is there a problem? Absolutely.
The 25 or 26 players who actually are known, you know, have tested positive, they've all said that it was at the end of a drinking binge.
Under the AFL's three strikes and you're out policy, even coaches aren't told about their players' first two positive tests. The Swans coach says it's unacceptable.
If one of the Sydney Swans players had tested positive, I would want to know.
With two of the country's most popular codes now reeling from drug scandals, a radical new plan is being proposed to help flush out the problem.
Well, we want to see them NRL, the drug test all players, over this 48-hour period, which will send a clear message to the community.
The NRL says that won't happen.
We're not going to implement a testing regime on every player in the lead up to the finals.
Anti-drug campaigners say the image of fit footballers getting high and being successful is hard to beat.
This will just reinforce some of those beliefs, which are very dangerous.
The millions and millions and millions that have been spent on the don't use drugs because it's going to do you too much harm. Crikey, Moses, this year has sent that down the Google, I would have thought.
Sean Berry, 7 News.
Time for sport with Ben Damon, and the poor old Knights can't take a trip.
Yeah, it's been a pretty tough day in Newcastle. Chris first, Andrew Johns, and now there's more drama at the club. We'll have that story next. The fallout from Andrew Johns' drug confessions dominated headlines, but there was more drama in Newcastle today. Unwanted forward Kirk Reynoldson broke down in tears as he pleaded with the club to let him stay, saying he's willing to take a pay cut. Kirk Reynoldson has always been one of league's nice guys. Today, this emotional plea.
All I want is to play with the Knights next year.
Reynoldson says he is willing to compromise on his contract to stay at Newcastle.
It has never been fully explained to me why I haven't been selected in recent weeks. Nothing would have been more satisfying than to play the last game of the season with my teammates.
A big win against the Knights would help the Tigers' finals chances, but their coach is not confident.
There's no way we can run anyone down for and against. We'd have to score 100.
Robbie Farah will play, but Sheens insists he's not the Messiah.
You know, you're not going to beat Newcastle with Robbie Farah.
But first, the scandal that has rocked footy fans in every code. NRL superstar Andrew Johns' sensational admission of drug abuse has blown wide open the crisis threatening Australian sport.
Did you know what it was when you took it?
Of course I knew
it. You knew it was ecstasy when you took it? When you took it off him and put it in your pocket, did you intend to use it?
Yeah.
You intended to use it?
Yeah.
It was a confession that stunned a nation.
You've only been retired from rugby league 4 months. So am I to assume that you were still taking drugs when you're playing days? I mean, does it go back that far?
Yeah.
How far?
Probably 10 years. Yeah, probably 10 years. I've taken on and off, generally during the off-season. But there's times when, during the season, I've run the gauntlet and played Russian roulette and taken it.
The all-conquering football genius Andrew Johns coming clean on a drug habit that overshadowed his glittering rugby league career.
You know, people probably ask, how do you avoid the drug testers? Well, you know, if you play a Friday night and you don't train on a Saturday, Sunday, then generally it's out by Monday.
How did you live with that lie?
I've lived with it for 10 years.
Brother Matthew Johns was almost reduced to tears.
It was actually Brian Carney rang me from Ireland, and someone had called him and said that Andrew, it was 3:30 in the morning, he rang and he said, mate, I've got some bad news on Joey. And knowing Andrew and his reckless behaviour, I thought he was dead. I thought this is the phone call I've been waiting for. And to be honest, when he told me he'd been arrested for drugs, sounds strange, but I was relieved.
Last night, Joey's interview with commentator Phil Gould was aired on both of the Nine Network's footy shows.
What I was surprised at was the vulnerability of Andrew Johns. I don't think I've ever seen him like that personally. He just looked to be really struggling with what was going on.
But even he was shocked at some of the revelations.
The fact that a lot of people knew about what he was going through and knew about the drug use, the fact that he was tested 30 times in 12 years and never proved positive shows what I've always believed, that you can beat the system.
Rival football codes have drawn together in disbelief on an all too familiar subject.
Well, it's a big shock. I mean, when you see fellas like that come out and make the admission that Joey did last night and the whole cousin singing, yeah, of course it's shocking.
We are a very lucky country. So wake up yourselves, you young people, and any other person who is just looking at life foolishly.
There's got to be something wrong. So I just think that if it was written on the registration form, if they are caught with drugs, they are out. They forfeit the chance to become a millionaire.
You know, my past 10 or 12 years has been like a fairy tale. And, you know, I've been so lucky, I've experienced so much, but I think about some of the great times I've had and they've just been destroyed because I've taken drugs.
Peter Stefanovic reporting.
Kupavuna, I think, had a bit of a clash there with Halitau on the way through. They both come off the worst for wear, and it comes for Bailey. Stood in the Morris tackle. Got it away to Zeb Taya. He comes back in field. A nice couple of fends there. Badiris passes on for Tenner. Back for Badiris. He's up on halfway. Danny Badiris still trying his heart out and gets as far as the 40. You expect nothing less from Danny Badiris. A class act. Gidley on for Waldo. Waldo gets it off right away. Then back for Gidley. It is game on here for Newcastle. The spoon isn't theirs yet, nor is a place in the finals for the Tigers. Gidley scores some superb rugby league in the build-up and the offload from Waldo. Yet another from the Newcastle Knights. A classic.
Well, it's been a long season here for the Newcastle Knights. I want Adam McDougall to talk us through this last try.
That was absolute magic from the boys there. Steve Simpson showed a lot of courage. He got his head taken off for a love bite, as I said before, and he still had the awareness and the ability to pop a great ball there to Kirk Gidley. Absolutely magic play from the boys. They're playing with a lot of spirit tonight, and I know we don't want to finish the year with a wooden spoon, and we definitely don't want to finish the year with a loss. But, you know, he's going to be a massive loss for us, Adam Warno. Very skillful, great flick pass, and even a better pass there from Steve Simpson back to Kirk Gidley. He scores a great try under the post. Great work.
24-18. here at Telstra Stadium. We're 6 minutes remaining. Perhaps we're going to need more than six to decide this one. Golden Point could be in the offering. Well, now the field goal becomes massive play. Marshall, was that his intention? Low kick, or did it fall off the tee just as he was making contact?
No, I think his body language was facing pretty much towards that eastern touchline. So it appears as though it was something he meant to do. I dare say he would have liked to have kicked it a little bit harder. It was an easy grab in the end for the Newcastle player.
Knights with the ball, Gidley fires it out. They're going to attack right to the death. With Abraham, can't offload in that tackle. Down he goes. While all this was happening, Ben Jeffrey, he's not going to see any football tonight. The young bloke on the bench for the Tigers. What would have been his first game in first grade for the season? Badiris down the short side. Here they go again. Funa holds it up. Carmont with the ball and a try saver. Liam Fulton back there for the Tigers. Last tackle. Badiris, Gidley. They got about six on one. Gidley's come up short. I'm sure it's a double movement. He had one crack. He came up short, and then I reckon he squeaked it forward just another little bit.
Well, this is great footy from the Newcastle Knights. They are not going to die wondering. Here's Kurt Gidley. That's a double movement. A double movement. Desperation got the better of him. His competitive streak, which he's famous for, has forced him to have another crack to get that ball across the white line.
What about the run of Vuna? It's all hindsight. If he passes earlier to Carmont, does he score?
Oh, I would have liked to have seen Vuna have a crack. He's big, he's fast. There were defenders coming up on the inside. Liam Fulton made a great grab.
No try penalty. That's an easy one as far as double movements are concerned. The Mad Dog's up on his feet in the commentary box.
Oh, great football here. What a pass from Denny Badiris. And Cooper Vuna, I'd like to have seen him back himself there. That's twice tonight that he hasn't backed himself. And it's quite evident tonight from the style of the Knights' play that they've definitely gone down that left-hand side of the field. When we played the Tigers earlier in the year, we did do that, and I'd like to think that was because I was there. However, I'm telling you now, it's because the West Tigers have a tendency to defend the smallest player on their right-hand side, and they've done that tonight with Benji Marshall, and we've come up with some joy, and I'm sure if they do make the finals, other teams will be looking to do the same.
Hyington plays it on the 40. I'll tell you what that replay did show. Superb defensive work by Hodgson. Just to hold back off Vuna. It allowed Fulton enough time to come back and get in position to make the tackle on the support player, Georgie Carmont. If Hodgson had a rush Vuna, it was a straightforward try. That is superb skill. As good a skill as he showed in attack to set up the last try for the Tigers.
Well, he's such a smart player. As we see the Tigers go to the left here.
I thought it was going to be intercept there for McManus. Morris's ball over the top. Now Lawrence, four to go. Can they get in field goal position? Hodgson's got the ball. They've got to look at Farrah. They have to look to Robbie Farrah. He's going to take a shot from about 30 out. Here he goes. Robbie Farrah. Defence came up on him. Had to pass. Chuiaki puts the fend on McManus. Goes over the top and is tackled. And Newcastle again, their effort. Superb in stopping Farrah from getting any sort of shot at goal.
Well, it hasn't been the prettiest of games. In fact, I think in total, there's been 25 errors. So there's been a lot of drop ball, but you cannot doubt the commitment of both sides. They're both desperate for victory. They're both trying hard right through to the dying stages.
Gidley and Abraham with it. Tackled by Fulton. He's had a stormer tonight, Liam Fulton, for the Tigers. Really good game. As now they attack down the left again. They got away from Marshall. Come on, away to Vuna. Vuna with a speed, he kicks. He's got Hodgson for speed. Cooper Vuna gets the bounce. Oh, yeah. The bloke who had the dandruff. He scores the try for the Knights. And he's put it down beyond the posts. They will have a kick from in front to get it to 24-all. They don't want that dirty wooden spoon. What a try from Newcastle.
The Lamington. This is good a job you'll see from a bloke on the wing. A la Jared Hayne. The state of origin has little room to move, but plenty of speed and plenty of skill. Puts the kick in, it bounces up perfectly. What do you think of that one, Mad Dog?
That is absolutely magic. I'm sitting here with a nice big smile on my face. That was great work from Cooper Vanu. And I tell you what, I would have liked to have seen the Lamington shake it, but he definitely did when he was down the sideline there.
This is to level up at 24 all. The Tigers and the Knights. Golden point not too far away. Tim Gilbert sideline.
Well, here it is. What a miserable old year it's been for Newcastle. This last 2 minutes and possibly golden point. Cooper Vuna. We saw the Maori sidestep last week. This tonight, a bit of brilliance. That's outstanding. The arm in the air. We've got some great minutes of rugby league on the way.
Cooper Vuna, the former Warrior, became a dad during the season. And a little post-try rocked a baby there. 90 seconds remaining, 24 all. And the Tigers can only wonder about a field goal attempt they had from in front. And Marshall missed. It'd be that back in the dressing rooms in 90 seconds time, toasting a victory had he got it. Knights have got it. 15 metres inside their own half. Tackle number three. They will need some big runs if they're to get into field goal range here. They've landed five this year too, the Newcastle Knights. It's been a while since they've been in position where they've needed one. Patterson. Well, they've carried inside the half. It's tackle number five. It's downtown. Gidley's going to have a shot though. Gidley off the boot. Is going to come out down 15 metres short. Tigers have it. Chuiaki with the ball, takes a run. They've done a great job on him tonight. McManus there again. Final 60 seconds with Lawrence now. He's wrapped up short of the 20. Tigers twice in this match have led by 12. Chuiaki tackled again by McManus. He loves this stuff. And now Galea. And for Hodgson, Chuiaki. Guess who tackles him? It's Brad Tye. Good guess. 40 metres out from the line. Hodgson up in the line, now for Johnny Morris. Dummy there to Hyington. Right across field, Patterson's got him. Then he stripped the ball off him. Newcastle come up with the ball. 10 seconds remain. Badiris has got him offside. They'll have a shot at goal. Badiris has got them offside. They had three markers. And Gidley will have a shot to win the match and put the Tigers out of business for the year. And possibly shed the wooden spoon for the Newcastle Knights.
I don't believe this. Great play here from the skipper to get the penalty. Shows how smart a player he really is. But Corey Patterson has come up with probably two of the biggest plays in this game.
Can I tell you something else that's about to happen? If Gidley gets this kick, South Sydney make the finals for the first time since 1989, regardless of what happens here tomorrow night.
Well, there's an excited little lady in our box. Look at her in the back. Little Louise.
Oh, boy. You Rabbits fans, suddenly you're watching this kick and Kurt Gidley's your best mate. A kick to put the Rabbitohs into the finals. First time in 18 years.
He'll get this mad dog money. He eats these up, Kurt Gidley.
All day. I can't put enough money on it. All day. Here we go.
And what's more, Broncos will be playing in the finals. Brian Smith, good luck to you, Brian. Here goes Kurt Gidley. The new Tigers fans. Maybe it's a rabbit's foot you need, hoping he misses it. 31 metres out. The Knights looking to end the 7-match losing streak. He's done it. What a finish to the year for the Newcastle Knights. They've scored two tries in the final 7 minutes. Gidley lands the goal on full time. And you've got to love what you've just seen. With apologies to Tigers fans, that is some sort of story that's unfolded here. The West Tigers are out of business for 2007. The Knights get a win in the final round. Their first win in 2 months. And South Sydney, the Rabbitohs, they're playing finals footy. Unbelievable. The Mad Dog speechless. What about the finish?
Great game of football. I tell you what, Bossy, that beer tomorrow is going to taste that much better for the boys after that effort. Great effort. Awesome effort. Words can't describe the feelings of the boys.
Incredible stuff. They'd lost 7 straight going into tonight, winning only 2 of their last 12 before this evening. Tim Gilbert in the centre of the very happy Newcastle camp.
They are absolutely going off down here, Bossy. Our Bundaberg Rum $1,000 man of the match, Jesse Royal. They're calling you Royal up there, mate. What a wonderful performance.
Yeah, mate, it was just good to get down there and get the win tonight. And it was just a great feeling to be out there with the boys for the last game, especially for some of the boys that are leaving the club. and it's just a great night to cap it off.
Jesse, can you explain the spirit in this side? It's been such a difficult season.
Mate, it's been difficult and hard with all the injuries and all the changes, but we've pulled through and we said we'll stick together, and so that's what we did.
How did you develop these wonderful ball skills?
Basketball, mate. Basketball. I was playing basketball for a while back home, and then I just gave league a go with the boys, and here I am.
You've done a wonderful job tonight, mate. Congratulations. Our $1,000 Bundaberg rum. Man of the match, Jesse Royal.
Thanks a lot. Cheers, Bundaberg and Channel 9.
Jesse Royal, wonderful offloads. Look at the looks on the Tigers players' faces tonight. You talk about your Bundy big plays tonight. Just put in a package. The Knights finish to the game, which included this try down the left side. Patterson, Carmont, and then Cooper Vuna, Ben Eichen. This is superb skill.
Oh, this is skill. This is everything. Speed, size. He's an excitement machine, Cooper. He's got a couple of post-try celebrations, and here's the goal. The 80th minute to put the Tigers out of finals contention, and there she sails straight through the posts.
Did you just see what you just saw? The Tigers players rushed up trying to block the kick. He would have had another shot at goal. Incredible finish. Kirk Reynoldson is down on the ground amongst all that is happening there. Back to Tim Gilbert.
Yes, thanks, Bossy. Well, here I am with Kurt Gidley. Kurt, talk us through how you felt. Let's have a bit of a walk. Talk us through how you felt when you did that kick.
Yeah, it was good. I mean, I wasn't overly happy with my performance tonight, so it was good to finish like that.
A wonderfully emotional performance by you guys.
Yeah, mate, it was you know, great to just chalk up one last win, and it's been a tough couple of months for everyone, but you know, as you can see the emotion there, it was nice to finish like that.
Well, I've got to ask you this. There was a guy in the start of this year that's not the here tonight. He had a difficult night last night, Andrew Johns. You got some thoughts for him?
If he's watching, I love you, Nuggie, and I'll see you soon, mate.
Mate, congratulations on a wonderful win. Kurt, go and enjoy it with your teammates.
Thank you.
The end of an extraordinary night, Channel 9's Friday Night Football. After the break, we'll have a look at exactly where we're at in the race to the finals. We do know the Tigers are out. We do know that Brisbane and South Sydney are in, regardless of what happens over the remaining matches this weekend. What a night. 26-24. Good on you, Newcastle. The win over the Tigers. And earlier this evening, the Cowboys over the Bulldogs, 38-32. After the break, the injury news, the race to the finals, what the coaches have had to say. Stay with us. Friday Night Football on Channel 9. Night football on Channel 9. A lot of you cynics probably thought the Newcastle Knights players would have forgotten the words to the team song without a victory in the last 2 months, but there they go tonight. They've pulled off a stunning upset over the West Tigers by 26-24, twice coming from 12 points down in the match. They were down by 12 in the first half. They were down by 12 with 8 minutes remaining here tonight. Incredible performance. Kurt Gidley getting the penalty goal to win the match in the final minute of play. Haven't they set up a remarkable weekend? And the Rabbitohs are in the top eight, well, in the finals.
Oh, that's right. I think the first time since 1989 the Rabbitohs are going to make a finals appearance. I mean, who would have forgot the marches through the streets of Sydney, how they fought so hard to get back into the competition. Round of applause to Russell Cope, Peter Holmes, of course, Jason Taylor and all these troops for a job well done.
It's a good point you make too, because Newcastle came to the aid of the Rabbitohs. Just on the controversy to end tonight's match, some of the Tigers fans upset about this stripping penalty, or rather the stripping play by Corey Patterson, that it wasn't a penalty. I'm happy to live with that. The replay shows that it's John Morris who makes contact with Denny Badiris. Denny Badiris plays no part in the tackle.
Well, I think it's a great effort from both players. I mean, first the strip from Corey Patterson and then this great play from Danny Badiris to identify that the markers weren't square, and there weren't two of them anyway. There was three of them there around the ruck. He gets his side the penalty, 30 metres out. It's left up to the fullback, Kirk Gidley, who's had a magnificent 2007 to slot the 2 points, and he gets it straight over the black ball.
And a few of the Tigers players there trying to charge down the kick, but the moment of victory for the Newcastle Knights. Now, they've been a club under pressure. So much bad press for them. Then last night,
Andrew Johns, the news that rocked the rugby league world on the footy show with the drug revelations. You can understand the relief in the camp when they got back to the dressing rooms tonight. Let's have a look at some of the pictures here. Brian Smith greeting the players back. It's as if they've qualified for the semis, not avoided the wooden spoon.
I don't think I've seen a team under the pump like Newcastle have been this year. I mean, they lost the world's best player in Andrew Johns. They've had Danny Badiris on the sideline, their captain, their inspirational leader for extended periods of time. I mean, the agendas that the press have set against them, the Kirk Reynoldson issue, I mean, to come out here and win tonight, I don't think it's going to make for a magnificent off-season, but it's going to make a hell of a lot less painful.
Well, let's hear from Brian Smith from the media conference just a short time ago, talking about the pressure that the team has been under.
Yeah, I thought that we were on the end of a really tough penalty count of 7-1 at one stage, and at some stages in the second half, I wondered if we were going to go through the same thing. Again, there were some incredible calls made out there tonight, which did everything it possibly could to stop us from winning those things. But the boys just got over that. They just kept coming back. It was a tremendous, spirited win.
Yeah, well, Brian Smith gets through tonight. He also said at the media conference he thought Andrew Johns' effort on the footy show last night one of the most courageous things he's seen in football. So that summed up the Newcastle side of things. But for the Tigers, that's the other story tonight, the demise of the West Tigers. Let's hear from their coach, Tim Sheens.
Yeah, well, 2 weeks ago, there was talk of the top four. And now we missed the eight. So, you know, that's how close the season is. And the games were close like that for us all year. We've all got games that have been won or lost in the last few minutes. So, we go to Cronulla where we kicked a wobbly field goal to win it, you know. So, Rick's had that sort of season. We all have, up and down. And, the pressure's on this year for everyone. The semis will be the same. And I'm sure next year will be the same again. So, you know, people are getting value for money, but the rest of us are losing our sanity.
That's the last quote from Tim Sheens, losing his sanity. Well, that wraps up all the news from Telstra. All right, let's get down to business. Show you the competition table as it stands after the two matches tonight. Now, here is what can happen. Well done to the Cowboys because they've got third spot sealed. The Warriors, if they beat the Panthers tomorrow, they seal fourth spot. They will kick off the finals next Friday night at Mount Smart Stadium. But some of the other possibilities. The Broncos can finish as high as fifth. The Rabbitohs can finish in the top four. In fact, if they beat the Roosters here tomorrow night, after that game, they are actually in the four. And it remains to be seen whether the Warriors can turn things around. The Bulldogs and the Eels can be the bottom two teams in the top eight. It's intriguing.
Hang on, I'm just doing some maths here. You know, yes. If the Broncos lose by 101 points against the Eels on Sunday, they can actually finish in ninth position.
Okay, yeah, by 102, in fact. It might be 102. Yeah, well done, Ben. You've raised that. So, Tigers fans, you've still got hope. I'd be probably more hoping for a comet to hit Earth, but anyway, you'll see how you go. Maybe if the APEC thing happened a little earlier, maybe the game would be cancelled, something like that. But the deal is, anyway, I just think it's remarkable. Knights may have avoided the wooden spoon if the Warriors beat the Panthers tomorrow night. Penrith get the wooden spoon. Tigers are out of business. Rabbitohs are in the finals. And the Broncos, just a quick word too, because it is 16 years straight in the finals.
That's exactly right. Since they won their first grand final in 1992, it's now been 16 straight finals appearances and 6 grand finals. A great job from Wayne Bennett and the men that have come under his charge over that 20-year history of the club.
And I know we're throwing up all sorts of scenarios, but come Sunday afternoon, depending on results tomorrow night, Parramatta could be playing for a place in the top four as well. So much more to be decided over this weekend. Thanks for your company tonight. Winners, the Cowboys and the Newcastle Knights. We'll see you again on Sunday.
This has been another presentation from Nine's Wide World of Sports.
Hello, I'm Neil Cordy. Welcome to Toyota Sports Tonight. It's the first day of spring. Football finals are just around the corner. We've got every code covered, so sit back and enjoy.
It's been a bleak year for the Knights, but they rallied around their fallen hero.
It's up to the rest of us to support him on that now, I think.
It is game on here for Newcastle!
We start with rugby league and some light at the end of what's been a very dark tunnel for the Newcastle Knights. They've produced a miracle to beat the Tigers and in the process have their say in who'll play finals football.
Finally, something to celebrate after the toughest week in the history of the Newcastle franchise.
He's done it! What a finish to the year for the Newcastle Knights!
The Knights winning after the siren, putting aside the distraction of Andrew John's startling drug admission and Kirk Reynoldson's ongoing contract dispute to engineer a sensational comeback.
Their first win in 2 months.
You know, we just went out and really wanted to do well for the blokes that are leaving and for Joey as well.
Andrew's done a really brave thing about his situation, and it's up to the rest of us to support him on that now, I think.
But for 73 minutes, victory looked unlikely. A double from Benji Marshall had the Tigers 12 in front. With the clock counting down their season, Newcastle drew inspiration.
It is game on here for Newcastle.
Then, after a year that's been short on highlights, Cooper Vuna provided a lasting memory to level the scores.
Cooper Vuna gets the mount! Oh, yeah! The bloke who had the dandruff, he scores the try for the Knights!
It was good. I had to come back and try and win the game for our boys, and I was just real happy.
The Tigers not so thrilled. That loss means they've missed the finals.
Our season's finished. There's nothing much I can do about it. Except look at the positives for next season.
The desperation for us to make the finals wasn't as much as those guys not to get a win spin.
It also means South and Brisbane safe in the eight.
We might send Newcastle a postcard though. Need a bit of encouragement. Thank them.
Bipolar battle. Andrew Johns, a psychiatrist, confirms the footballer has suffered from severe depression for years. Andrew Johns, a psychiatrist, has confirmed the football star has been clinically diagnosed with bipolar disorder, one of the most severe forms of depression. Johns gave his doctor the go-ahead to talk publicly about his ongoing battle, and his supporters hope it's another step forward in his recovery.
Professor Gordon Parker diagnosed Andrew Johns with bipolar disorder, the worst form of depression, 3 years ago.
This is a mood condition where people have highs as well as lows, and as the mood goes up, they're much more likely to drink alcohol, and sometimes, of course, when they're depressed, they'll also take drugs and alcohol as a way of self-medicating.
Johns does not want to use his condition as an excuse, but like his confession about taking illicit drugs for the past decade, going public about bipolar is the quickest road to recovery. The suicide rate for bipolar, the highest for any psychiatric condition.
Just as Winston Churchill had bipolar disorder and worked his way through it and just kept working, Andrew is a sporting example of tackling bipolar disorder and trying to get on with the task.
While Johns battles bipolar disorder, politicians are trying to make mileage out of his drugs confession. Both major parties are now demanding standardised testing for drugs in all sports.
A national approach, uniformity across the sports, an agency which can assist in doing that, but most importantly, the funding to make it work.
It's a bit late in the day for the Labor Party, which has been silent throughout this debate, now to belatedly come into the debate.
Wayne Bennett says Andrew Johns' drug and alcohol problem was the worst kept secret in rugby league. The Broncos mentor worked closely with Johns when he played for Australia and Bennett was national coach. Bennett claims politicians are only just joining the war against drugs, a battle being led by sports like AFL and rugby league.
We're not trying to do something about it, we are doing something about it.
What's more, high profile drug takers like Ben Cousins, Wendell Saylor and Johns are just fall guys for a problem that's reached crisis point.
I don't know, you know, why we have to continually parade our sportsmen. You know, if you're a doctor or a solicitor or, you know, politician, whatever, no one else gets paraded like our people do.
Not even journalists were safe.
Your media organisations, how many of your guys are going to a day full of Eki pills and what are you doing about it? You know?
Last night, former Newcastle teammates ended a woeful season with a rare win. With John's drug confession still fresh in their minds, the Knights rose to defend their fallen hero.
My personal feel was that it was one of the most courageous things I've ever seen.
Andrew McKinlay, National 9 News.
Stephanie Brands with sport, and we now know all the NRL finalists.
Mike, the Tigers won't be there after their shock loss to the Knights. Last night's upset 26-24 win by the Knights over the Tigers has settled the top eight. It's now just a matter of where all the teams finish.
And what a dramatic finish in Newcastle. The Tigers looked home. They led 24-12, but it got down to a penalty right on full time, and Kurt Gidley delivered the killer blow.
The Knights looking to end the seven-match losing streak. He's done it! What
It's been a year they'll never forget. On and off the field, never has the club been so weighed down with issues, and they may still finish with the wooden spoon. It made the loss even harder for the Tigers to take.
Congratulations to Newcastle. Commiserations to us. We've just got to work harder for next season. That's about it.
Parents say no thanks to Andrew Johns' offer to educate their kids about drugs. Parents are warning Andrew Johns to stay away from their kids following his astonishing confession of a decade of drug use. The former rugby league great wants to turn his life around by becoming an anti-drugs crusader. But some mums and dads say too much damage has been done.
Andrew Johns has always been loved, still is, by fans.
He's sort of my hero for Newcastle and everything.
And teammates.
Obviously he's a close friend and we all love him.
And some parents.
We all make mistakes and just let it be.
But for many whose children idolise rugby league's greatest.
I think it's appalling.
I've spoken to my kids about it. And that's all you can do.
When Andrew Johns confessed his sins of habitual drug taking and alcohol abuse, he also revealed his salvation, an anti-drugs crusade.
Now, I'd like to somehow influence young people or young players.
For Andrew Johns, that chance for redemption may be shouted down by the thousands of parents he's disappointed. Many say he has no credibility lecturing on the dangers of drugs when, as a drug taker himself, he succeeded in life so spectacularly. Sydney man Tony Woods certainly has an opinion on it. Ecstasy killed his daughter, Anna.
He must never be allowed to go in and talk to our kids as a role model because he's lost that status.
And children are asking questions.
It's actually a little bloke's idol. He is, so he's asked a few questions and he understands it all.
The youngest fellow, he wanted to know sort of what is ecstasy.
At a time when drug abuse in football is under its greatest scrutiny, questions over why they should get more attention than anyone else.
If we went out and did random drug tests in everybody's workplace, who knows what would come up?
In your media organisations, how many of your guys are going to a day full of Eki pills and... And what are you doing about it?
Robert Ovadia, 7 News.
Also tonight's a kick in the teeth for the Tigers as the Knights finally shine.
He's done it! What a finish to the year for the Newcastle Knights!
Tigers blew theirs.
2 weeks ago, there was talk of the top four. And now we've missed the eight.
We're just shattered with what's happened.
We might send Newcastle off. Postcard though, need a bit of encouragement. Thank them.
The 2005 premiers needed to beat the last place Knights to qualify. Benji had a double.
Back for Marshall.
And at 24-12, it was looking good for the Tigers.
That is skill.
But something had to go right for Newcastle. They needed the extraordinary. Kiwi flyer Cooper Vuna provided it. The try levelled scores, a last-minute one-on-one steal, and Kurt Gidley penalty goal broke the Tigers' hearts.
The summer sits a whole heap better with that win.
Still, the Reynoldson saga continues, and Danny Badiris was coy when asked if he would still be a Knight next year.
Mate, I'm contracted.
Matt Carmichael, 7 News.
Now, before we get into on-field action, the big issue, of course, this week were the revelations made by Andrew Johns on Thursday night's footy show. Plenty of repercussions. It's been in all the press, front page, back page, middle pages. You can't get away from it. Remiss of us not to discuss it as well. We've got a current player here. We've got the welfare and education officer, newly appointed in Jason Stevens, and a guy who's been part of that, part of our game as well, and very close to clubs as well for many seasons. What was your reaction to what you saw on Thursday night?
I thought it was a tough night for Joey. He'd obviously done the wrong thing. But the flip side, I guess, of having a profile and being involved in professional sport, above and beyond all the good things that come with it, is that he's had to go out, and because of that profile he's built and the fact that he's such a wonderful rugby league player, was bare his soul on national television. Everybody and anybody that knows rugby league, that knows sport, will now know Andrew Johns, see him in the street, and know what he's got up to. And that's the baggage he'll have to carry through the rest of his life.
He purged himself on Thursday night because I think the thing, you know, when it was first advertised, a lot of people thought, oh, sweetheart deal, this is, you know, he's going to go along with what was issued on the press release that someone gave it to him. I think the depth of what he went into on Thursday night was the thing that surprised me, Brett. Were you surprised at all that as a current player to hear that?
I was. I was very surprised at the fact that he donated so much information that wasn't actually asked of him. You know, the problem with having the ecstasy tablet when he got caught, you know, that's what I thought he was going on to talk about. But to pretty much bury his soul on TV was it's an admirable thing to do as well as a tough thing for him.
Dealing with players' welfare and education, has it made your job easier or harder, do you think?
Yeah, look, I've only just started, but it's made it challenging because the NRL, from what I know, they've spent a lot of money, a lot of time, a lot of energy into sending an alternative message to young people. And when the game's best, the best that I've ever seen, you know, comes out and can play a great career as he has, and then beyond that, it's going to be challenging. But I think it's going to be used for the good because it'll highlight, you know, players' responsibility and hopefully we'll use it for the good.
How do we react to this as a sport? Do we look at... We have a one-chance policy, which is something that the league have looked into, and basically it differentiates between catching somebody who is an habitual user and a young man who makes a decision, a bad decision on one night, so that there is a something between those two. In the aftermath of this, do we take that away now? Do we
No way. I can't understand where the anger comes from people outside sport looking at sport and saying we've got to get tougher on this. I mean, drugs is society's issue. You've got to give everyone an opportunity, I guess, for a second chance. That's what the NRL do.
Yep.
Second strike and you're out. I think all codes in sport here in Australia are getting the three areas around drugs pretty much spot on. They've got the education at the front end when you come into the game, which Jason's now a part of.
Yep.
There's the testing. I mean, our athletes get tested more than anybody else in any other walk of life. And at the end, at the back end of it, you know, if they get that second strike, well, then they're out. You make an example of them. And like I said before about Andrew, all our players, if they do get that second strike, they're going to have to carry that infamy through with them the rest of their life into whatever job, into whatever role they fill. That's the flip side of professional sport.
You mentioned, you know, people saying we've got to get tougher, but you look at the NRL at the moment and in-house testing, every club's got to do a minimum of 70. That's a lot of testing. Mm. You look at the club like the Broncos who do 300. So, you know, I mean, it's there. It's definitely there. They've put the time towards it.
Well, one thing that Andrew didn't delve into too much on Thursday night, but it has come out in the last couple of days, is the fact that he does have health issues. One of those is a diagnosis of bipolar. Now, the man who diagnosed him was Professor Gordon Parker from the Black Dog Institute. Channel 9's Andrew McKinlay caught up with the professor during the week and asked him what the difference was between normal depression and bipolar disease.
Well, normal depression is what everyone gets, to feel sad and a drop in self-esteem and feel hopeless and pessimistic. But for most people, after a few minutes or hours or a couple of days, you feel better again. Clinical depression has a greater severity to it. It lasts for a couple of weeks and is a much more physical state when it's part of the bipolar condition. A person feels a black fog or a black dog around them in feels their concentration has dropped right away. They lose the light in their eyes. They find it hard to get going in the morning. They can't be cheered up. They can't look forward to anything. And then suddenly they'll flip into this converse state, which is a high energy, high mood state where you're energetic and you're disinhibited and you're creative.
What's good about Andrew going public with confessing that he has bipolar disorder? Will that help in his recovery?
It may help him, but it has the potential to help so many other people. Andrew has been a role model as a sportsman. He has the capacity to be a role model in terms of people understanding more about bipolar disorder, realizing that with bipolar disorder, you can still be a sportsman at the highest level, that also you can take medication, and Andrew has been on fairly heavy medication, and yet he's played superbly. So there would possibly be some personal advantage in him discussing the bipolar disorder, although I think, like, you know, many tough sporting blokes, he doesn't want to be seen as using it as an excuse.
And I don't think that's the way it's come across, that being used as an excuse. Now, part of that interview as well, he touched on the effects of alcohol. Now, look, I don't know Joey that well. I've socialised with him and that, but I think even on Thursday night, he admitted that alcohol is the problem. And you know, if you're a mate, you'd be saying to Joey now, if you get off the alcohol, when he's on the drink, basically good sense goes out the window. Yep. And that seems to be the catalyst. Obviously, it exacerbates the health issues that he has, but it also leads on to temptation. And if you can take that part of it out, I think that's the first thing that Andrew will be looking to to get under control, I guess. But anyway, it's been a huge week and has taken away a little bit of the focus, unfortunately, of the finals football, which is coming up next weekend. Now, we've had five matches in round 25. We're up at Townsville on Friday night for the Cowboys, too good for the Bulldogs, 38-32. Defence wasn't a priority there with 70 points being scored. And this was a huge result against the Tigers, as we heard earlier, the Knights getting up 26-24 at Telstra Stadium, ending the Tigers' chances of playing finals.
Andrew Johns was caught in possession of an ecstasy tablet.
I put my hand up, I was going to take it. I've done the wrong thing, you know, I'm so ashamed of it. To be honest, I sort of used it to escape all the pressure and stuff.
The show the players trust.
Trying to explain to a seven-year-old son, I'll never touch a drug again.
To give their side of the story.
To influence other people, I think that's the greatest thinking I've ever.
The Footy Show Live, Thursday, 9:30.
Channel 9.
Oh, there's been some pretty hard stuff, you know, but if you feel like, you've thought things through and you're making decisions that are right, and the people around you have contributed to those decisions, the administration and the coaching staff, and we're locked into those things. Well, you know, it's only right and proper that people out there will cut that up and make some mileage out of it, because that's what you do, I guess, from time to time. But, you know, I'm confident what we've done is the way to go. It's not easy. It's been tough and it's upset some people, but, you know, the proof will be in the pudding further down the track. I'm happy to live with that.
The heart and soul of this club in many ways, the greatest player of the modern era, bared his soul in the most raw, transparent fashion on TV last night. Your thoughts on what you saw?
Well, I've seen Andrew Johns do remarkable things like we all have. And, you know, he played that grand final in 97, first one the Knights have ever won. And, you know, I wasn't around, but folklore has it about his rib and a potential lung injury. And, you know, he turned out to be the match winner on the day. And he's played in so many games. You can't play that long and not play busted and be so tough and courageous as he's been, but I thought he put all that in the shade last night. It was something that I don't think very many of us would be prepared to do. I thought he opened himself up, and his honesty, and it's just a remarkable thing. I admire him greatly for doing it.